magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. United in your resurrection, you lift us to infinite heights. Could anything sever or take us from? Magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. How great, how sure, His love is. Time to worship. Come,
Good morning. Let's all come in and have a seat. Hello, everybody on the live stream. Glad you're with us. Let's join our hearts together in song.
I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I'll sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth.
Good morning. Welcome to Southside. I'm Jeremy. I'm one of the ministers here. I just want to welcome everybody here this morning. We're glad you're here with us. And man, we want to show that to each other this morning. So, you know, as people come in, if somebody needs a seat or something, let's scoot over. Let's make space for people. And man, let me just encourage you today to reach out to someone. You know, go talk to somebody you haven't talked to in a while after service. Check in on somebody. Give somebody a call. I think today, you know, Sundays where we come together as family, it's a great day to be reminded that we're here for one another as well. So let's reach out. Let's talk to somebody. Let's check in, see how everybody's doing. To our visitors, man, we are especially glad that you're here. And our hope is that we can kind of hang out with you afterwards and get to know you a little better. But we also want to ask you to send an email to help us better connect with you. So you can send that to BarrettKaufman@gmail.com. Barrett is also one of the ministers here at Southside. You'll hear him say that sometimes. And so you can shoot him an email, and that'll help us get in touch with you. You can also use that email for prayer requests. So please be sure to send prayer requests to us. That can be for the entire congregation to know and be praying about, or it can just go to the leadership team. So you just let us know when you send that prayer request. But there will be people praying about whatever is going on in your life, whatever's on your heart throughout the week. And we want to be serious about our commitment to prayer. And so we really want to ask you to send those to us. There's been a lot going on at Southside lately. There's been a lot happening. It's been pretty exciting. Last Sunday night, we had Solid Rock, which is kind of our annual talent show, dessert, and coffee house event. Our youth group hosted it this year. And so, you know, part of that is raising money for them to go on mission trips. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you to everybody who performed, to everybody who brought in desserts and food, and just for everybody who showed up to make it a fun and good night together. You also gave a well over $3,000 for our students to go on mission trips. And so I just really want to express our thanks. You are giving them some awesome opportunities. This summer we'll be going down to Big Creek, which is a missions organization down in kind of southeastern Kentucky. And so we've served there before and are excited to do that again. And you're making that possible. So thank you for that. I want to also briefly mention the Women's IF Conference that happened over the weekend. Our youth group worship team got to be part of the worship. And just, you know, from the time we got to spend with everybody, it seemed like an awesome, awesome weekend. And my wife went and was really blessed by it as well. I know lots of work and planning went into making that a meaningful time. So I just want to say thank you to that team and for everybody that was involved with that. So that's a lot that's been going on. Let me tell you about the next thing coming up here in another few weeks, and that's our Celebrate Marriage. So that's going to be on May 20th, and you know the goal of this is it's a weekend to strengthen your marriage, and that's whether you're engaged, about to get married, or you've been married for 50 years. It's designed to bless you in your relationship with your spouse. You can go online to the website. There's a link there where you can sign up and register for that, but that'll be a weekend we get to share, or Saturday we get to share together to strengthen marriages. I also want to mention another date a little further down the line coming up, and that is VBS, Vacation Bible School. So there's the dates up on the slide. So, you know, June 4th through 8th. Now is the time to put that down on your calendar. Some people have said better than Disney World. Better than Disney World. So it really is a great week together, and we're looking forward to it. And that's ages, 3 through 5th grade. And so much work and, planning and energy goes into that. And so we just want you to know about those dates and be looking forward to that as that comes up. Now, for this month, we have been doing communion a little differently, and I've really been enjoying it personally. But in a few minutes, you'll be invited to come to the table to receive communion. And when that happens, there are six tables that you can go to. So there's the two up here, there's two in the back, and then there are two back in the foyer. And the two in the foyer have the gluten-free option. And so during that time, you can go pick up the bread and the cup and take it back to your seat, and you hang on to it until we take communion together. Again, we're glad you're here. We're excited to worship together. So let's continue to do that.
And VBS is cheaper than Disney, too. And a lot more rewarding. All right. Everybody take a deep breath. Let it out. I don't know what's been going on in your week, but everybody in this room has a different story. You're in a different place in life. But we can rest on the fact that God is the same. It's the same yesterday that he is today. He's going to be the same tomorrow, and he loves us so much. So let's stand, and we will praise his name.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Let earth and heavenly saints proclaim the power and might of his great name. Let us exalt on bended knee. Praise God, the Holy Trinity. Praise God, praise God, praise God, who saved my soul. Praise God, praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise to the King, his throne transcends, his crown and kingdom never end, now and throughout eternity. I'll praise the one who died for me. Praise God, praise God, praise God, who saved my soul. Praise God, praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, praise God, praise God, who saved my soul. Praise God, praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below.
Father, every good gift comes from you. We rest in you this morning. Thank you so much for saving our souls. We were dead people walking around, and now we have life, life in you, covered by the blood of the Lamb. We honor you this morning, and we give you our praise as a sacrifice. It's in Jesus we pray. Amen. Have a seat, please. During the next two songs, you are invited to come to the table to get communion and take it back to your seat and hold on to it.
In need of grace, in need of love, in need of mercy raining down from high above, in need of strength, in need of peace, in need of things that only you can give to me. In need of Christ, the perfect Lamb, my refuge strong, the great I am. This is my song, my humble plea. I am your child. In need of grace, in need of love, in need of mercy raining down from high above, in need of strength, in need of peace, in need of things that only you can give to me. In need of Christ, the perfect Lamb, my refuge strong, the great I am. This is my song, my humble plea. I am your child. I am in need. In need of Christ, the perfect Lamb, my refuge strong, the great I am. This is my song, my humble plea. I am your child. I am. I am your child. I am indeed. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Stay. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Have you ever gone to a wedding and you walk in either as you're going into the foyer or maybe you're going into the reception and there's a board of photos, right? And we see the bride as she's growing up in these photos and the groom and then some photos of the couple together, right? We're looking back, we're reflecting on the past. But in that ceremony, we're celebrating with the couple in the present. And we're also anticipating with them for their life ahead. You know, we're getting ready to enter commencement season. We're really conscious of that in the Going House because we've got a graduate this year. So we're looking back, right, at the last 18 years. And we're getting ready to celebrate in that moment of graduation. And we're also thinking about what's ahead, what God has in store for Eli's next phase of life, right? There are these moments in life where we look back, we ground ourselves in the present, but we also anticipate what the future is going to bring, and the Lord's Supper is one of those moments for us, right? In 1 Corinthians, Paul says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So we look back. We look back to the cross. We're reminded of the sin that makes Christ's death necessary for us. We may take inventory of our sins during this time and confess those. And as we remember the cross, we likely are thinking about our unworthiness of God's gift of grace and mercy and love. But we're also in this moment when we take the emblems, we're prompted to really express thanks to God for what he's given us, for why we're able to have this celebration as a body of believers. And he is present with us, right? But we're also looking ahead. The very act of coming together as we do every week at the Lord's table is our declaration of our confidence in the fact that he's coming back. Right? He's coming back. He's with us, but he's coming back. John says in 1 John 3:3, "Everyone who hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure." So as we share communion this morning, I hope we can remember the past, we can experience renewal in the present, and we can anticipate that wonderful future that God has promised us. You know, the cross is not some dusty historical relic. We remember our Lord who died, but he's not dead. He lives, and we have a living hope because we have a living Lord. Would you pray with me, please? Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. You are the eternal I Am, the God of the past, present, and future. Lord, as we take the bread this morning, let us remember what you've done for us, what you continue to do, and the promise we have in our future with you. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. You pray with me as we prepare to take the cup. In you, Lord, our God, we put our trust. We trust in you. No one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame. As we take the cup this morning, we ask that you remind us of your sacrifice, of your mercy, and of your love. Show us your ways and teach us your paths. Guard us, Lord, and protect us because our hope is in you and in your unfailing promises. God, we ask these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all the world has ever known. Above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what your worth. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the and thought of me above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what and thought of me above all. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above.
Let's pray for our kids head out. Father, my prayer for our kids this morning is that they would be deeply rooted in you, and that they would turn to you for everything that they need. So Jesus, we pray. Amen. All right, if you're new with us, we have a time for our kids called We Worship and Kids Own Worship, 2 years old up through third grade. And you'll just need to escort your kids there and pick them up after church is over. Let's go ahead and be turning to the passage for this morning. We're going to be in the New Testament, the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. Colossians 2, 8 through 10. All right, everybody got it? All right, put that off to the side and let's stand for this next song.
Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us go in this world wherever we roam. Ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart holy words of our faith, handed down to this age. Came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart.
Please be seated.
Be reading this morning from Colossians 2, 8 to 10. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. Let's pray. God, thank you for being with us today. Be with Jeremy as he takes us through your word. Help us all, God, to listen and to get rid of distractions and be able to focus and know that you're here with us. In your son's name, amen.
All right, thank you, Bart, for that prayer and for reading God's word for us. 5.5 years ago now, I became a parent, and it has been awesome. And there are so many parts of it that are great, but one great part is that you are reminded constantly of what it's like to be a kid. So here's an example. The other day, I was talking with my son, and he said, you know, if lava ever comes to our house, then, and I said, wait, what? He said, you know, like lava from a volcano. As we talked, it became clear to me what was going on. You see, my son, he's learned about volcanoes and lava, and he has seen lava depicted in media. You know, it's often this obstacle that the heroes have to overcome, right? Lava's coming out and they have to get across. He has played games like The Floor is Lava. And as I thought about it, I realized, man, there's a lot, like a disproportionate amount of lava-related things in his life, right? So as far as he knows, lava is a very real, imminent possibility. lava could show up at our house. And so he was trying to come up with a plan and let me know about it. He was like, here's what we're going to do if lava comes. Apparently you and mom aren't thinking about these things, so I'll take it upon myself. So I explained to him, you know, he doesn't have to worry about lava here in central Kentucky. But it did make me think, right? It made me think. Because when I was a kid, there were a lot of things I thought might be a problem, but they haven't really popped up in my life. And maybe you're the same. For example, I've never once stepped on a banana peel and slipped, right? Hasn't happened. Now, I will say, I did step on a rake once, and it flew up and smacked me right in the face, and it hurt, but I also was just so shocked that I'd gotten cartooned by a rake, you know? How about this one? Maybe you remember this, the Bermuda Triangle. Do you remember that being a thing, like, growing up? I mean, it was this huge mystery, right? Part of the ocean where ships and planes just vanish. I remember, like, Scooby-Doo or maybe the Hardy Boys solved some mysteries there. Like, I was kind of concerned about the Bermuda Triangle, but I guess I don't have anything to worry about. I haven't heard about it in a long time, right? Now, this next one, I don't think it's really my fault, but I was often told growing up that I was going to run into this problem, that if I did not master math growing up, I'd be in trouble because, what, you're not going to have a calculator in your pocket everywhere you go. For some reason, that hasn't really been a problem that I was told it was going to be. But, you know, when it comes to things you worried about as a kid that turn out to not really be a problem, I think the king of all of them has to be quicksand. Quicksand. When I was growing up, quicksand was everywhere. You know, Robin Williams, his floor was turning into quicksand in Jumanji. Scrooge McDuck was stuck in it, right? Pinky and the Brain ran into it. One of my favorite movies, The Neverending Story, had this terrible, oh, I see people's faces right now, this awful, awful, terrible, depressing quicksand scene. And I'm so sorry for reminding you of it if you had locked that away in your head. And then, of course, there's the famous scene in Princess Bride, right, where Princess Buttercup, she just, like, phew, vanishes into this pit of sand. And Wesley, out of his love for her, he doesn't hesitate. He grabs a vine, he dives in headfirst, and he rescues her. And it just seemed, growing up, as if quicksand was going to be a bigger deal. You know what I mean? I mean, I either read about this or like, an adult taught me about how to survive if you fall into quicksand. And I know that because I still remember what to do, right? You stay calm. You float on your back. And someone else can reach out with a stick or a vine. But you do not go in after the person yourself because you'll both get sucked down there and you will die in quicksand. And it turns out that's not even true, right? Quicksand, in reality, it's more of an inconvenience than a danger. You might lose a shoe, but you're unlikely to ever sink down past your waist. But as a kid, I mean, quicksand was on my radar, you know? And then one day, you grow up and you learn you don't have to be worried about quicksand. Well, sort of, right? I mean, at least not that type of quicksand. A few weeks back, we looked at Colossians 2, 6 through 7. And in Colossians 2, 6 through 7, Paul tells us to be rooted in Jesus. He says Jesus is our foundation. He's where we're supposed to draw life from. And if we are rooted, if we are anchored in him, we will grow into these healthy and full people. He is the source of our life. Now, I want you to see in the next verses what Paul says here in verse 8 specifically. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world, rather than on Christ. You see, there is quicksand. There's soil, there's ground that looks secure. You know, it's the sort of ground you could build your life on. It's well researched. It's a popular place to build. But the reality is, it is quicksand. And Paul says there are these philosophies, these ideas that are vying for your roots, and he says they are hollow and deceptive. And if you build there, the ground will give out. And you'll sink. And so I want us to consider this, that there are these other voices that want you to take root in them. But first, we have to remember, I mean, Paul didn't write this letter directly to you and I, 2023, right? So when Paul is talking about hollow and deceptive philosophies, hollow and deceptive voices that want you to take root in them, he has something specific in mind, right? So this morning, I would like us to travel to Colossae. All right? So this is modern day. This is where Colossae was. This is a modern day map. But if you were to travel, you know, to Rome in the time of Paul's day, it would look something more like this. There we go. And maybe you can see right there, it's like above Lycia, right above it. And so they have kind of done their best to recreate a map of what the city of Colossae might have looked like. And so this is their best attempt at kind of a recreation of the city. So if you can, imagine for a moment that we're there, right? And I want to introduce you to some of the voices you would have run into in that city around 40 AD. And I've asked some of our youth group guys are going to help me out this morning. They're going to come up now. They're going to take maybe three over here, three over here, and they're going to represent some of these voices. They gladly volunteered, not really knowing what they were doing, and so I appreciate them so much, all right? Now, this was a time, right, and they're going to be standing up here a long time, so you guys just get comfortable, all right, just enjoy it, all right. This was a time when there were so many different ideas about philosophy and religion, right? You originally had the Greeks, and they had lots of gods, lots of different ideas about life. And then, of course, the Romans came in, and they took the Greek gods, they changed their names, they brought in new gods, they combined some things together. And as the Romans conquered other people, they just kind of adapted their gods, right? And so in a city like Colossae, it all just blended together. I mean, there was a bit of everything. It was like one big melting pot. And so here's the first one we're going to run into, all right? Mr. Ethan, you're going to be... Sorry. I'm going to let you put it on next time. Okay. You're going to be Cybele, okay? Cybele. So Cybele was kind of seen as a mother goddess, all right? Which I think Ethan really exudes some of those characteristics. And she was represented by lions. They carried her around in a chariot. She was the goddess of marriage and love. But not just the goddess of marriage. It was really kind of any kind of love that you wanted. And so there were these festivals in the streets where they celebrated a very physical love with lots, just kind of everybody who was there, stranger, friend, everybody. And so if we're kind of just to boil it down to one ethos of Cybele, it's this: you need love in every form, right? Let's go for it all, okay? Next up, we're going to have Isis, all right? Nathan's going to be Isis for us. Now, Isis, she was an Egyptian goddess, okay? She was brought over from Egypt. Now, she was the wife of the god of death, Horus. After he was cut up into pieces, she went and put him back together and wrapped him in bandages to keep him held together. Sounds like a what? A mummy, right, yeah, absolutely. And she was the goddess of magical power. Nathan, maybe you can just like a little, yeah, perfect, all right. And in the myths surrounding her, she often uses her magic to outmaneuver and trick others around her. And the worship of Isis often focused on the same, these spells and incantations that could give you what you want. All right, that was kind of what she was all about. So for Isis, we're learning as we go. You need magical power over others, right? That was a key idea behind her. All right, next up, Mr. Avery is going to be Serapis. Now, when the Greeks conquered Egypt, the Egyptians and the Greeks had trouble getting along. As you might could imagine, you weren't super excited to hang out with people who had conquered them. So this guy, Ptolemy I, he invented a god, all right? He invented a god. He combined some aspects of Egyptian gods with Greek gods. And here's it's fascinating to me, right? When we think about like the gods of Rome, gods and goddesses, we're like, well, you know, they were fake. There were these man-made ideas and stuff. But at the time, I mean, everyone knew that Serapis was fake because this emperor literally just invented a god to get people to get along, right? Everybody knew it was made up, but it didn't matter. And lots of people worshiped Serapis. And so the idea behind Serapis was you need to get along, right? You need to come together. You need to get along. That's what it's really about. All right, on the other side, we're going to work our way through. We had Mithras, okay? Now, Mithras, Eli, was the god of secrets and mysteries. Can you look mysterious, Eli? Oh, yes, perfect. All right. All right, that was brilliant. And Mithras and the cult of Mithras, they had all these secret symbols and gestures, secret handshakes. They had underground temples with hidden entrances. Only those who were members could worship, and only they could be told the secrets and mysteries. It's interesting. I mean, we actually know very little today about what they actually did in their meetings because they were so secretive. So for... So for Mithras, the idea here is you need our secrets. We have secret information, and you need it, and only those who are part of us can have access, right? All right, now this next one, you're probably a little more familiar with some of these than with some of these other ones, because it's Judaism, right? Now, Judaism was obviously around at the time. In fact, that was Paul's life, right? And now this was, obviously, there were different ideas within Judaism at the time, but it was certainly a time when many Jewish people were putting a great emphasis on keeping God's commandments, right? And you see this especially in the New Testament among who? The Pharisees, right? I mean, they're all about it. Of course, they had the Ten Commandments, and they were, you know, they wanted to keep the Sabbath holy. But man, they had gone a step further and a step further, right? Detailing how far you could carry things on the Sabbath before you were breaking the law. They mapped out all the details, all the interpretations of how to perfectly adhere to God's commands. So certainly there was a line of thought within Judaism that's all about you need to keep the rules. And man, maybe you can give us give us something like, you gotta keep the rules or else. Yeah, all right. Brilliant. Finally, the last one, we have the moon goddess, Selene, all right? Selene. Listen, I asked the youth group, they volunteered, and it was six guys, and so here we are with a bunch of goddesses represented by our boys, and it's fun. So Selene was the moon goddess. She was all about wisdom, all right? And with Selene, you would look at the stars to tell the future and discern answers to life's biggest questions. You know, the idea the truth is there if you know where to look. People are still doing this today, right? And so with Selene, the idea was these stars have the answers you need. And Gray, maybe you can just if you could peer into the stars searching for wisdom. Oh, that's good, that's good. Here we are. This is it. This is Colossae. I mean, there were certainly more. This is probably a small sampling, right? But these are some of the ones, some of the philosophies, some of the cults, and some of the religious groups that we know were represented there. And it's into this world of all sorts of philosophies and ideas that Paul writes Colossians 2, 8 through 10. And you can certainly see why. Right? I mean, what a confusing place. All these different messages about what really matters and what's important and what you should build your life on. Now, of course, this was 2,000 years ago, right? What good are Paul's words today? I mean, does 2023 America look anything like, 40, 50 AD, Colossae? Well, let's consider it. Let's think about it for a minute. So we have Sibylle here, right? Who says you need love in every form. Now, we don't have processions out in public, going out into the streets and doing physical stuff in public with strangers. But man, romantic love is still a huge part of the conversation. In fact, we have lots of people talking about love. You know, a few years back, one of the places we see this discussed most often is in our art, in our songs, in our movies. I remember a few years back, Ed Sheeran, he released this song called Perfect. I'm sure you heard it. You know, it's Dancing in the Dark with You Between My Arms, right? You don't want to hear me try to sing it. But it was this romantic ballad, and it was focused on marriage. It was written about his wife-to-be. A beautiful song. It was the number one song of 2018. It was played so much, even that in 2019, it was still the 13th song on the charts. So it had some real staying power, right? Here is what blows my mind. Around that same time on the chart was a song called Freaky Friday, okay? And the lyrics are filthy. All right, lots of sexual stuff, very degrading toward women, and there's this total perversion of the romantic love. And there's apparently a music video for it. I have seen it based on the lyrics. I would not recommend checking it out. But guess who's in it? Guess who guest stars in this video? It's Ed Sheeran. Yeah, he shows up in it. The same guy who writes all this beautiful stuff about romantic love, about love within a marriage. He's in this filthy video. And so our world today hasn't changed too much, has it, right? I mean, when it comes to love, the only real ethic regarding love in many people's minds today is consent. And consent is an important thing. But man, there is less and less value on commitment in romantic relationships, right? And very little regarding love and sex is considered sacred or holy. And so the story goes that, man, no act, no expression of love is unhealthy or dangerous or harmful as long as the people involved agree to it. You still need love. You just, if you want to flip around for us, Ethan, today it hasn't changed too much. You need love in whatever form you want, right? We're still basically worshiping civilly. Isis. So there's probably less people today looking for magical power over others, although there's been a weird like uptick in like interest in witchcraft in the last about 2 years. But regardless of that, we are still looking for power over others. And just as a side note, you know, if you're looking for power, it does imply that it can be used against others, right? That's the definition of power, something that you can wield against the people around you. So whether it's the push to do more and more in school so you can get one step ahead of your classmates, or it's empowering people by weaponizing their sexuality, maybe it's the slew of like politicians and Hollywood executives who have misused power against people, or I mean, we've seen church leaders do the same, right? We've seen people lash out with power through violence and school shootings. The pursuit of power is still alive and well. And so if you'll flip for us, maybe it's not magical power, but you still need power over others. Now, Serapis, if you remember, by the way, somebody out there is going to be like some Greek scholar or something, and I mean, I checked YouTube for all these pronunciations for record, so... Serapis, if you remember, was all about inventing a new truth to bring people together. And we don't have those kind of problems today, right? We don't have issues getting along, certainly. You know, an article came out last month about how people are refusing to date or even be in friendships across political party lines. And there are even dating apps for very particular political groups. So Red Yinta is a dating app for socialists, okay? And Donald Daters, you can guess, is exclusively for supporters of Donald Trump, all right? They're dating apps for very specific groups of people. And man, this is probably not a surprise to you because, man, you know how polarized things are. And we're losing this idea that when you have a deep disagreement, you can talk with the person, and perhaps you can come to understand their position better, or perhaps you can persuade one another of a virtuous cause. At the very least, you can find some common ground. But instead, today, when someone disagrees with you, it's an indicator that they are evil and hateful, and they're not deserving of conversation, consideration, or friendship, certainly not your love. In Colossae, you were supposed to get along, but today that's not enough. Today, if you'll flip for us, you need to agree with me, or else you're evil and hateful. Mithras was all about secrets. Eli, can you do your secret thing again? Yeah, all right. Now, we don't have secret religious groups today, right? Well, we kind of do. I mean, there are things like Scientology, where you kind of buy your way into the religion, and then you get access to more and more information and secrets as you go. But I feel like we are probably not here likely to go become Scientologists, but man, our world is full of groups that let some people in and keep some people out, right? I mean, some sororities and fraternities operate this way, right, where they have secrets and not everyone gets in, and it can be all about who's in and who's out. And we all encounter this. This isn't limited to sororities and fraternities. Whether it's the clique at your school that makes it so obvious who's in or out, or your clique at your work that does exactly the same. I was shocked to find out, you know, as a kid, I was like, I guess you grow up one day and these things aren't a problem. But we know, man, no, this still happens. This still happens. Human beings, we have this tendency to exclude and to keep people out and to let people know who's in and who doesn't belong. I mean, it can happen here so easily if we're not careful, if we're not intentional about the way we love each other. It's all about, you know, being exclusive to others so you can feel included. And so it's less about you need our secrets, but now today it is about you need to be included. You need to be a part of us. Now, Judaism, of course, is still around. And while there are still some communities that practice Judaism in a way similar to the people of Paul's time, generally people are less interested in the specific rules of Judaism and more interested in the whole picture. And the need today, you can go ahead and flip for us, Manning, is you need to be a good person. You need to be a good person. And that's what's gonna save you. As long as you're a good person, it doesn't really matter what you believe or think. But there are still some problems here, right? I mean, how good do you have to be? What's the line, right? And who determines what good even is? I mean, people don't agree on what's good. Look at politics, right? You see how divided we are over what we think is good and best. Another problem with being a good person, how do you know if you're the good one? The only thing you can do is you look at someone else and you compare yourself. And so it's less about, am I a good person? Am I a better person? Am I better than them? And you're always checking others to see how you compare. And finally, we come to Selene. Give us the look again, Gray. Yes, man, so intent. Strangely enough, there are still quite a few people looking at the stars for answers today. You know, about 1 in 4 Americans believe in like horoscopes and that sort of thing. But there are other people looking at the stars too for other reasons. I'm thinking of like scientists, right? And man, what an incredible gift, like science, that our world is ordered and reliable and consistent in a way that allows us to learn and flourish and better the quality of life for others. What an amazing gift from God. I'm grateful for it. But I want us to think about this. How far does it go? Because there is this prevailing philosophy today that expresses itself in so many places in our lives that there is nothing we can't eventually figure out. That every question, every problem, social, political, emotional, everything can be solved with the right thinking. And this is not really a problem with science. This is a belief in myself. It's this idea of self-sufficiency. It's this idea, if you'll flip first grade, that you are all you need. And when you are the answer to all your problems, it becomes almost impossible to recognize your own failings and shortcomings. And if the right thinking really is the ultimate answer, then people with differing ideas, well, they're holding us back, right? And so I'm justified in demonizing and hating and mistreating people who disagree with me. So here we are. Welcome to Colossae or welcome to Lexington, right? Things haven't changed that much. Not that different. Still a world full of voices trying to get us to put our roots down into them, to invest in them, to draw our life from all these other things rather than Jesus. In a way, it's a little depressing that the world hasn't changed much. But in another sense, there's something good here. Because here's what it means. It means that Paul's next words to us can apply right to us, just like they did to the Colossians. So right after warning us about this, about these hollow and deceptive philosophies vying for our attention and commitment, Paul says this, "For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority." Paul tells us that in a world full of voices, the only thing that is actually full is Jesus. Everything we need is in him. The fullness of God, the one who made it all, right, lives in Jesus, and in Jesus we are filled. And all these other voices, Jesus has power. He's the head over every power and authority. We've been looking at this idea of being rooted. And maybe that phrase resonates with you. Maybe you've been through a time of great change, a move, a career change, an illness, a new school, loss of significant relationships, and you felt adrift and lost. And so you understand that need to be anchored, to be rooted in something. But the problem is not that we feel this need to be rooted in something as the source of our life. The problem is what we choose to be rooted in. And so Paul has this flashing neon sign pointing us to the answer that everything you need is in Jesus. You know, the voices of the world, they say, you need love in whatever form you want. And Jesus responds, he says, I am the one who loves you perfectly and forever without condition. The world says, you know, you need power over others. Jesus says, I defeated the powers of sin and death for you. You need to agree with me, or else you're hateful and you're evil. Jesus says, I am your Savior. I saved you so you can love your enemies. You need to be included. And Jesus says, I am lifted up to draw all people to myself, and we are all one in Christ Jesus. You need to be a good person, and Jesus says, I am the one who frees you to be good. And the world says, you are all you need. You are all you need. And Jesus says, you were never meant to be without me. And that's why he was willing to go to the cross, because we're not self-sufficient. We are meant to be with Jesus. It is like the Princess Bride, okay? Because when we, each and every one of us, we stepped into quicksand, right? And we sank. And there was no hope. There was no chance we could save ourselves. We were going to die down there. And so he dove in. He dove in after us at his own expense, and he pulled us up from the pit of death, and he rescued us, and death couldn't hold him either. Let's thank these guys, and we'll let them go have a seat. Thank you guys so much. You can take those with you. You know, there are so many things about your life and my life that I just don't know. I don't have the answers to. But I do know this. Jesus is the one for you. He is it, okay? He's the one you're meant for. And the world will tell you, you need. But the truth is, Jesus is the one you need. All the rest of it, it's just quicksand. We're about to stand and worship together. And if we can help you, man, we would love to pray with you, to talk with you, just to sit, to be with you. But man, we would like to know if there's some way we can help you on your journey with Christ. If you want to put them on today in baptism, we'll make it happen. If there's anything we can do for you, please let us know as we stand and worship.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when things are still, striving seas, my comforter, my all in all. Here in the love of Christ I stand, in Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live, there in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slay, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands for victory, since curse has lost its grip
fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever block me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Gregory, thank you for great and meaningful worship today. Bart, thank you for reading in your prayer. Brad, great comments on our communion time together. Jeremy, man, you've touched me. So many people would be afraid to give that message. But we, as Christ followers, need to give that message. We're asked to spread the good news. Our life is not about us. Our life is about Jesus. And thank you very much. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we just thank you for this time that we're able to be together, for this time of worship, this time of grounding and rooting ourselves in you. God, we're in a evil world, in a dark place. The world tells us life is about ourselves and whatever we want, whatever we want to be true is our own truth. But not one of us is good without you. Not one of us can understand truth without looking at it through your lens. Father, you are the truth. Jesus is the truth, the light, and the path. And Father, just help us to know that, to really root ourselves in that, and to not be afraid to share that with others as we try to share the gospel and the good news. Father, bless us as we leave this place today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.